We're gonna teach you how to build a softy tank. Why? Soft corals come in some amazing colors and shapes. Some of them are inexpensive and grow really fast. They require low lights and low flow, so you don't need to buy expensive gear. And once they grow out, your tank will look like a lush underwater tropical rainforest. Don't forget, we are building 5 unique habitats for this innovative marine 40 tank. To see the gear we're using, how to set everything up, and the other habitats we've built, check the playlist link below. There are hundreds of species of soft coral, all of which are located in the order Alcyonacea. But taxonomically speaking, the following 2 corals are technically not soft corals. We are going to include zoanthids and corallomorphs because they share a lot of similar characteristics. Broadly speaking, all of the above corals are distinct from stony corals because they do not secrete a calcium carbonate skeleton. They are mainly comprised of soft tissue and calcium-based sclerites, which give them structure. Here is a list of just some of the soft corals you will commonly come across in this hobby. Gorgonians, Ricordia mushrooms, zoanthids and polythoas, star polyps, leathers, zinnias, discosomas, clove polyps, rhodactis mushrooms, and nepthia. Worldwide corals supply the majority of the soft corals you're gonna find in our tank here, and as always, when they arrive, we temperature acclimated them, drip acclimated them, and dipped them before putting them in our water box for egg system. Soft coral tanks are great for beginners because they're easy to care for, they do well in higher nutrient systems, and they grow quickly to fill your tank. But softy tanks are also a great option for seasoned reefers who just want a low maintenance system. A low PAR range of 25 to 75 PAR works well for this style tank, and you may not even need to buy a wave maker because the return pump might provide enough flow by itself. One quick note of caution, some soft corals can secrete a toxin from their tissues, so I always find it's a really good idea to run some activated carbon at all time. Also, if adding zoanthids and polythoas to your system, be sure to always wear safety goggles, a mask, and gloves anytime you handle them because they can secrete the highly toxic polytoxin. We chose to keep the Carib Sea special grade sand from our previous system since it's already been cycled. But since this tank will be a low flow system, you could get away with Fiji Pink, which has slightly smaller grain sizes. But I would definitely recommend staying away from sugar fine sand as we're gonna be putting a lot of these soft corals directly onto the sand bed itself, and we don't want that really fine sand to be blown around and cover up our corals. I probably use somewhere around 10 to 15 pounds of that Carib Sea special grade sand, and my goal was to create a less than 1 inch deep sand bed throughout the tank. This time I did evenly spread it around, but you could taper it from front to back as that slight difference in height does give a greater sense of depth, especially in a smaller tank like this IM40. I'm not gonna sugarcoat it for you. I really struggled building the aquascape for this habitat. I looked at a lot of fully developed soft coral tanks and I asked myself the question, what type of aquascape would get me to that goal in 1 year? I also knew that I needed a lot more empty sand space than most of my other tanks because a lot of these soft corals are going to be placed directly on the sand bed or on a small rock island. For this build, the flow pattern was not nearly as big of a consideration as low flow throughout is sufficient, so I was able to place the rocks along the back wall, not really worrying about the flow behind them. I just used about 4 pieces of pre-cycled Carib Sea Life Rock, maybe around 15 pounds total. And I actually built the scape a little backwards from how I usually do it. Rather than just start with the aquascape first, I added in some of my larger coral pieces before starting the aquascape. I figured it would be easier for me to figure out where those larger pieces went first and then build the aquascape around them, filling it in later with the smaller soft corals that I have. I'm not thrilled with it, but I think it will provide enough habitat for the corals to grow into. My initial overall goal was to stack the pieces of rock from left to right high to low with some small pieces in the front right. I was going for some sort of mountainous, volcanic runoff feel, but at the end of the day, it just looks like one large chunk of rock. So instead, to give it a little more depth, I created a couple peninsulas running off of that main rock from back to front. To accomplish this, I use an already created Zoa garden and a Rhodactis mushroom rock that I already had. I use Tropic Marin Pro Reef Salt for all my tanks. I primarily like it for two main reasons. Number one, it mixes clear, so during storage, it doesn't coat my 50-gallon drum with a brown residue. And number two, it provides a good level of consistency between my frag system and my display tank, so anytime I need to move livestock or corals, it's less of a shock to their system. Since I use pre-cycled reef rock and sand, I didn't need to add any ammonia chloride or beneficial bacteria to cycle it. For this softy tank, here are the ideal parameters I'm going for. 77 to 78 degrees Fahrenheit, a salinity of 1.025, pH as high as possible but hopefully above 8.0, nitrate 3 to 5 parts per million, phosphate 0.05 to 0.1 parts per million, alkalinity 9 dKH, and calcium 415 to 425. But to be honest, I'm not stressing about these numbers very much. As long as I can keep them in the ballpark and somewhat consistent, I am confident that my soft corals will thrive in this system. The wonderful thing about softy tanks is they don't need fancy lights. In fact, one AI Prime 16 HD is all you will need for this system. I mounted it with the 12-inch flex arm and just put it smack dab in the middle of the tank. I always set up my LED lights using the Kelvin option. How I do this is I set the intensity to around 40%. Then I adjust the Kelvin until I'm happy where it looks. I personally prefer a Kelvin at around 10,000 degrees because I don't like overly blue tanks. For this IM40 softy tank, 11,500 Kelvin seemed to hit that sweet spot for me. Once the Kelvin's decided, then I adjust the intensity until I get my ideal PAR range, which for me was about 30 to 40 PAR in the corners and no more than 75 PAR at the top of the aquascape. At the end of the day, I achieved all of this with an intensity of 34%. And for all of you who are curious, here is the schedule I'm running. Sunrise starts at 7 a.m., a slow ramp to full intensity from 11 a.m. until 4 p.m., and remember, full intensity for this system is actually 34%, and then a slow ramp down until lights out at 8 p.m. Since I had the powerhead, I decided to use it. I'm using the Ceche Extreme SDC powerhead. It is set to impulse mode between 0 and 40% max. It creates a gentle pulsing motion throughout the tank. I have the MightyJet DC return pump set at 1.2. For filtration, I'm using a filter sock on one side and the acrylic caddy on the other. And in that caddy, I am using fiber filter balls, a small baggie of high capacity GFO, and a small baggie of ROX 0.8 carbon. When Worldwide Corals asked us what corals we wanted for this build, we said, send us a good mixture of soft corals, nothing high-end or super expensive, but a good representation of what hobbyists will be able to find when looking to build a tank of their own. They sent us a great mix of leathers, mushrooms, zoas, clove polyps, GSP, and nepthia, to name a few. A softy tank will not fill up overnight, so just buy one or two new corals as your budget allows, and then watch the softies grow out over the first year into that lush underwater tropical rainforest we talked about. When it came to coral placement strategy, I started by spacing out some of the pieces I knew would grow up and out quickly over the course of a year, especially the toadstool, nepthia, and cyanularia. I know how big they can get, and they can get ridiculously large, so I put them on the back wall of the aquarium, so as they grow, they won't block out the light and shadow the rest of the tank. Next, I placed my two larger pieces, the zoanthid garden and the Rhodactis mushroom rock, where I wanted them. From there, it was just a mix of finding what I thought was a good spot for each one of those corals. I placed the smaller corals towards the front and the larger corals towards the back because if you do it in reverse, then the larger corals block out your view of the smaller corals behind them. I also gave plenty of space to my mushroom corals because some of them will give nasty stings to their neighbors. I kept my zoanthids and GSP on their own islands. That way they don't quickly grow onto the main aquascape and overtake the other corals that are already there. Do note that with this kind of aquascape, and since so many of the pieces are placed directly on the sand, they will be moved around from time to time as they grow out and just for my preferences. If you decide to go with similar corals for your softy tank, don't be surprised when it grows out super quickly and you have to create frags to give away to your friends. Since this softy tank had already housed the Euphelia and Fimbriophilia tank, I already had a small cleanup crew added, namely some small conches, hermit crabs, Cerith, Nassarius, and Astrius snails. I also have a pistol shrimp and a sand sifting goby from the previous build, but I would definitely recommend against getting a sand sifting goby. I just know from experience that as my sand sifter settles in, he or she is going to cover all of my corals on the sand bed with a layer of sand, and I'm gonna have to be constantly going in and cleaning them off. When it comes to fish, this softy system is absolutely perfect for a whole bunch of small fish that like to hang out in the water column because there's just a lot of open space in this build. We'll link to our top 10 beginner fish videos in the description below. The biggest problem you're going to run into with a softy tank is overcrowding. Your corals are gonna grow so fast that you'll be watching videos very shortly on how to frag soft corals. You may even end up having so many pieces that you'll have a side hustle selling some of these to pay for your hobby. One nice thing about soft corals is you most likely won't need to feed them very often. Although I do dose the tank about every other day with Red C AB Plus, and I do broadcast feed the tank with some fine coral foods about once a week. It's usually a mix of phytoplankton, reef chili, and Brightwell's coral aminos. How I like to do it is I turn off the return pump, but I leave the wave maker on. I pour in that mixture, let it circulate around for about 20 minutes, and then I flip the return pump back on so that all of that extra food gets filtered out by the mechanical filtration. This is gonna be a low maintenance tank for me, so hopefully I'll only have to do water changes every other week. As long as you change your mechanical filtration and your carbon frequently, you shouldn't need to add a reactor or a protein skimmer. But if you do end up stocking it heavily with fish, you may have to add those things over time. I am dosing a small amount of Tropic Marin All for Reef via a BRS doser, but honestly, you don't need to do that. I would just test for your calcium and your alkalinity every week, and then just hand dose a small amount as needed. In 6 months to a year's time, this softy tank is going to be stunning. But what changes might you need to make if you want to add in some frog spawn, hammer, and torch corals? Well, click the playlist right here and I'll show you exactly how to do that. And as always, everyone, thanks for watching. Happy reefing, be well. We'll see you next time.